Hey, we're live. We are live indeed. Hello, everyone. This is the very first free speech art stream. And I'm John Kraft. I'm really glad to be host tonight. With me is Jennifer Dawe, GM Chivers on Twitter. And, well, welcome. On this 4th of July, on this day of America, you are going to be greeted by cheeky Frenchie, a crazy Canadian, and an Australian. I don't think I need an adjective to add to this, personally.
How about a delicious Australian?
Yes, I'm sure that's exactly the word I was looking for.
Hello, ladies.
So yeah, we'll congratulate America today by having no American person on the stream talking to today. And so, for the ones wondering what this stream might even be about, this is free speech. And this is going to be about mostly free speech issues, debating about it, talking about it, and culture, art, freedom about making, creating, and all of this. It's not only for artists, it's also for audiences. Jennifer Dawe herself is an artist, she is a developer. She's working right now on Cityscape with a what's his? I remember his Twitter handle. It's three-headed dingo, but I can't remember his actual name. I apologize.
Jason Brown.
That's right. I deeply apologize if he ever listens to this. So she's working on this game. She managed to gather quite a bit of attention for it, actually. It's a very cute game. It looks really nice. A bit Harvest Moon-y for the ones who have played this kind of game. So, yeah, she definitely is an artist, since she is making stuff. You're the designer, you're the artist, you draw for the game. The art style is yours, definitely. And I'm myself, a French... I'd hate to call myself a writer because I haven't published anything. So that would be maybe a bit arrogant of me, but I am. My work is writing and movie making. So both of the hosts are artists themselves, and they are deep in art. And I'm French myself, though I don't have a choice anyway, but being into art and culture. So this is the free speech stream. The point of the stream isn't merely to talk about it, but to promote artists overall and to defend free speech and creative freedom.
And to say and, rude words.
Exactly. The saving the world is on our hands. But the point as well is to promote artists live. And as you can see, tonight we have Patrick Gordon, an artist. You have the links to his to some of his work in the YouTube, in the video's description, if you ever want to take a look at it. And he'll be drawing for the night with us and showing off some of his talent. And obviously with us we have Dan Mapplethorpe, who is an artist as well, an Australian artist.
It is important that I am Australian.
Exactly.
It affects, like, I think about it every day as I draw. I'm Australian. How do I represent Australia?
Exactly. Is there any other Australian artist besides yourself?
No, I'm the only one.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
Yeah. We only just got electricity last year, so it's kind of hard for us to get known and be on the internet.
Yeah, I know what you mean. I definitely know what you mean. We have those guests tonight, and I do hope that we can make it enjoyable, interesting, informative, and beautiful as well, thanks to the artist tonight, and yourself, obviously, the audience, because there is no artist without an audience, of course. Dan, I'd like it if you presented yourself a little bit in a more thorough way than just I'm Australian.
Oh boy.
Talk a bit about yourself.
Okay. What would you like to know? What would you like to know about?
Well, for example, what art are you... what would you say is your art? The art you work on?
My art? Well, I'm a professional illustrator. I've been working for about 10 years, and I've been an artist, just amateur, all my life. Mm-hmm. And, yeah, just recent years, I had to leave a permanent position for health reasons, and I'm trying to get into the freelance part of it.
Yeah, that's a bit complex, I heard. It's difficult
It is a bit. But I'm finding it's really good joining up on the social networks and getting my art out there, and people are getting interested, and they're making commissions.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm
really enjoying that.
Your work and a bit your living as well.
Yeah, yeah. It doesn't make quite enough right now to make a proper living. So I've got to, yeah. But
you'd have to be famous for
hopefully,
that.
Hopefully soon I'll be able to get, yeah.
Yeah. Well, good luck.
You know, that's one of the sacrifices, I guess, if you want to do art as a living. sometimes you're not going to be able to be supported 100%. You're not always going to have a...
Art, yes, definitely.
You're not always going to have a 9-to-5 job or a permanent position somewhere. Sometimes you're just going to have to do something else or and just wait for opportunities. Keep working hard in the meantime.
Yeah, that's part of the life of an artist. Except, of course, if you have sex with the right people.
Whoa!
We're just gonna go right into that.
Well, I'm French.
You can't say that. I won't allow it in this free speech stream.
That's going to be my excuse a lot, by the way. That's going to be my excuse a lot. I'm French, and that's why I'm saying that.
Outrageous. Just absolutely disgusting. I'm appalled.
I'm sure you are. You definitely sound like you are. Jen, did you want to say something? Add to that?
I swear that I turned the chat on. I checked it days ago, and I checked it again before it started. I have no idea why it's not showing up, so I apologize for that, but I did... I know that it's chat or riot, so I specifically went through to make sure it was on, and I don't know why it's not on.
Have you refreshed the video?
Yes. Oh. And I don't see it.
We have someone here with us that would be definitely willing to help. So if you're watching live, we have Stius who is helping out, and if you do ever have a message or want to see specific drawn live or any comment, don't hesitate to hit Stius on Twitter. It's Starius, Stius, just like it's pronounced, I suppose. And hit him up on Twitter, and he'll relay it to us while we find a way to make the chat happen. If we ever do find a way, we apologize. That's extremely unprofessional of us. And we'll whip ourselves daily for it. So thanks a lot, Stius, for the help. So if you have any comment, any ID, any demand, please do hit him up on Twitter, and he'll relay, and we'll reply or discuss it all. If it's interesting and part of the conversation, of course. Dan, that's amusing that you mentioned you were working in freelance. One of my favorite, I don't think that the word is comedian, but maybe comedian on the internet is David Thorne. He's an Australian who became famous because he made. Very silly email replies.
Ah, oh, right, yes.
He became famous mostly when he made a very, very funny reply to someone asking him, he had to return some money, I don't even remember why, and he said, well, I'm sorry, I don't have the money, so here's a drawing of a spider I made, and it was a terrible drawing, made on paint in 20 seconds, something like that. And he said, yes, I'd say, I'd wager it's worth $500 and 27 cents, or something, what he was owing to the company. Here's the drawing, and it's yours, and I believe that now we are done with the transaction. And it was the back and forth between the person asking for the money and him really making it all silly. It was hilarious. I love the guy. And and he actually became very famous thanks to this. He had a lot of success thanks to his jokes and very serious, really fucking stupid mails and all that. And he was a freelance artist as well, who complained a lot about his colleagues all the time. and it's pretty hilarious. I tell everyone to check up David Thorne online as well. And obviously you, Dan. You have all the information about Dan and Patrick in the video description. And so, yeah, maybe this stream, as the very first stream of free speech art, which will obviously become one of the most famous streams on all of YouTube, if not the most famous stream on YouTube, in a few months' time. And everybody will remember Dan, the very first guest we had, and you will be famous and rich, and you will have all the girls you will want. Because this is obviously...
Oh, fantastic.
This is the only reason an artist becomes an artist.
Clearly. I mean, I don't give a damn about what I draw. I mean, it's just... It's all about getting rich and famous, honestly.
anyway, you're talking about your freelance work and all this. It reminded me of David Thorne, obviously, simply because he's Australian as well.
We also both like drawing seven-legged spiders. That's exactly. another great...
common interest.
It's a similarity that most Australians share, based, of course, on the native seven-legged spider that we have.
Yeah, better than murdering spiders, yeah. like Australia apparently does have.
Murdering spiders?
Yeah, you have spiders that kill everyone.
Well, we haven't had them officially charged as of yet, but some spiders have killed people. Yeah, and it's very sad. I'm not sure why you brought that up, John. Jeez.
I'm sorry. It's free speech. I'm allowed to mention anything I feel like mentioning. You know, this is the point of free speech. If I want to talk about murder victims and call them pricks because they're not even alive and they can't defend themselves,
I'm allowed. Don't even say anything bad about Steve Irwin. I mean, just don't even say anything.
I'm going to shit talk Robin Williams, and everybody is going to hate me for the next 500 years because I shit talk Robin Williams.
Seems Patrick would like someone to suggest something to draw. Yeah. I would like you to draw food that is better than French food. That'll be pretty easy because all French food is terrible.
Yeah, thanks.
Isn't that right, John?
Yeah. I'm not at all going to take this personally. Of course not. anyway.
People in the comments are getting angry at the lack of chat. Harmful opinions, who we did the logo for. It's plug, plug, plug. Oh, he is getting very upset about the lack of chat.
You did the logo for Harmful Opinions.
Yes. Yeah, there it is. He's asking for chat or riot. there's a freeze peach gate already.
Yeah, of course.
On our so-called free speech stream, there is no free speech because the chat's not open. And yeah, that's all I have to say about that.
We apologize for that. Please do comment and share all the hate you have to give us. Because we failed at our obviously only job.
I just went and looked, and it is seriously the box has been ticked the whole time. I didn't touch anything. I turned it on 2 days ago. I didn't touch.
Have you tried turning it on and off again?
I have heard that 10 times in the last 5 minutes.
Yeah, but it gets funnier each time, doesn't it?
No. Yeah, I'm sure it definitely does. Oh, geez, why did we even invite this guy? Anyway.
Thanks for all the ladies. I'm here for the female crowd. Right.
I'm here for the rice balls.
Oh, yeah. Onigiri is okay. It's good food, but it's not better than French food. I'm sorry.
Wow.
This is very offensive, isn't it? Yeah, our stream is going to reach critical levels of offensive material, content. You can count on that. Anyway, I felt like since we're talking about free speech and freedom to create and publish and all this, it would be only fair to mention the way Australia recently has been working along the ideas of free speech and freedom to create. And I read an article this week on Escapist, on the Escapist magazine, written by... What?
Sorry, I was just reminding everyone that was a big shill.
Yeah, definitely. Well, I'm going to mention my 3D waifu, Lizzie Finnegan.
I texted her once on twitter.com.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank God you mentioned the .com, otherwise we wouldn't have understood what you were mentioning, what you were discussing. thank God. So, my 3D waifu, Lizzie Finnegan, I hope I'm pronouncing this right. She wrote an article, and it's titled "Australia has banned over 200 games in 4 months," and it's about the fact that there's quite cognitive dissonance apparently with Australia, which considers that art is art and all is fair in art, except in games. In games,
it's very strange. There is quite a big grasp on games still. Very recently, they've been banning all kinds of big popular games that are overseas considered all right, but here it's like, oh well, no, those zombies look too much like humans, and if people are killing humans in video games, I don't know about that. So you got Left 4 Dead 2, I think was banned, or maybe Left 4 Dead 1 and 2 both got some sort of censorship treatment. One was banned completely, and the other was edited, I think, to have green blood instead of red blood.
Oh, I think I heard.
I think Mortal Kombat 3 was banned. Of course, this is all from, stores and things that are in Australia.
So it's not necessarily government.
Online stores using a VPN to get around blocks of whatever. You can still get the games, but they still try to ban things in the year of our Lord 2015.
That's amazing.
In the age of the internet, trying to ban violent video games. They're okay with sexy video games, though.
I'm fine with that.
And I think the only one that's been banned is that Rayplay thing from Japan. I think that's the only one that's been banned. But everything else, fair game. It's like the anti-USA.
Okay, I get you.
In Australia, it's... you can't have violence, but sex is okay for kids. and then an American's like, violence is fine for kids, but I don't know about this sex. We gotta ban this. So we don't get to enjoy someone being ripped down the middle in Mortal Kombat unless we use the internet, which I think most people have since we got it last year. In Australia, That's opened our whole world up for us. I'm very happy to the, you know, appraise the great koala every time I use the internet, you know, because he gave that to us, and yeah, I'm very honored.
Very thankful, and grateful.
Yeah, I'm grateful to have this privilege.
I don't see the point of playing a game if you can't rip someone in half in it. Like, what's the? I do hope, Jen, by the way, in your game we can rip animals and cute little things.
Yes, please. For free speech, we want blood and guts mode in Seedscape.
I don't know. I feel pretty sad even just thinking about having to make monster death animations. Like, when you have to beat up the monsters, I'm just like, I can't make them ugly and I can't make them die. But I have to do it for science.
That's cute.
Oh, that's sad.
That's pretty cute. Sorry, I'd like to remind people, just in case, since we don't have the chat, again, apologies.
Tell John that baguettes suck in the comments, since we don't have a chat.
I'm going to blow
everyone
up.
Everyone upvote the fact that baguettes are terrible.
Yeah, and I'm going to have a Philfish meltdown on Twitter and tell everyone that you suck because you hate baguettes!
Kitty Moo Moo says, do you think people have the right to edit another person's artwork? I think it depends, and like mostly it's an etiquette thing. I personally never saw the purpose in like Sonic recolors and stuff like that. Like, I just, it was one thing as like a learning thing, but some people make it an entire identity, and I think that, like, yes, while the Sonic hype train is big, you might get attention for that. Long term, it is not going to really help you professionally unless you draw Ed, and Eddie naked, and then you can work for Cartoon Network. But I don't like edits. It's not really a legality thing or anything like that. It's just, for me, it's like, sometimes it's funny, like, if people are like using Sprout for a meme or anything like that, it's kind of funny. But like, if you're seriously trying to make a career of that, you might want to rethink, you know, Sprout a chew.
Oh, I'm making it now. That's gonna be the next t-shirt.
Oh my god!
But you know, Seed Bro, buy Sprout a chew.
Well, Seed Bro is a good example of like fan art that we were like, hey, this is pretty cool, and that worked out for you, but you did not make that your whole life.
I think there's for kids, it's understandable to make edits, because when you're a kid, what art is what other people make. And so
right. You
kind of appropriate everything and adapt everything to express yourself through art, but it's always kind of everyone else's expression, which is kind of the point of a child, to be fair.
Right.
But once you grow up, you're supposed to grow out of it as well, and to the idea of, okay, I want to do my own stuff. And so, not even talking about plagiarism, by the way, which is totally a different, way bigger issue, but really the notion of someone did something and I want to put my own self on top of that thing that isn't actually me, or that isn't on the basis of, on the basics of it, it's not me. It's someone else made that thing, and I'm just going to put something that makes it look like a bit like me. And
yeah.
Okay. As soon as we finish this train of thought, I have to say something.
Just letting you know.
Okay. Oh, am I allowed now?
One thing, I just wanted to mention that one thing. If you do have comments, and because we don't have a chat, we feel terrible of it, at the very least, I do feel terrible.
I blame John. It is all John.
I hope you do. Again, don't hesitate to hit up Starius on Twitter, STARIUS. And he'll transmit everything to us because he's such a cool guy. So, yeah. Just wanted to remind everyone in case they have something to say and shitpost to Martial. Please do go on, Dan.
I'm just going to call out harmful opinions here. Apparently he's talking some smack about Tim Tams. And I will have you know that Tim Tams are the best biscuit in the entire world, bar none.
I don't even know what they are.
I feel very strongly about Tim Tams, and if you think that Tim Tams are worse than French cuisine, you can go jump. Basically, that's it. Yeah.
I have no idea what Tim Tams are. But I utterly trust that
okay,
Dan
see, well, this is
what...
why French cuisine is not as good as the rest of the world. Like, you don't have Tim Tams. You don't even have Tim Tams. How am I supposed to take your wine and cheese seriously?
We don't have.
How am I supposed to enjoy a baguette when I know you don't have Tim Tams to compare anything to?
We don't have Tim Tams and we don't have Hot Pockets.
I don't know what mouthpiece art is.
Mouthpiece art? Oh, there's something else that we got. Mouthpiece art is popular on Tumblr. Opinion on edit. Yes, no?
I have no idea what mouthpiece is as well.
I have not heard of mouthpiece. I hope it is something inappropriate, so let's keep saying it. Mouthpiece.
Thanks.
Mouthpiece.
Anyway, back on the topic of Australia banning everything. Literally everything.
Literally everything.
Literally everything, even people. I even heard that they banned pretty much anything that is erotic with smaller-chested women because it would be pedophiliac in nature or something like that.
Oh, yeah.
Apparently, you can't make porn with small-chested women.
Honestly, that doesn't
affect me that much, so I don't really care. But it is one of those strange...
DFC
it's one of those strange arbitrary things where someone decides, this adult woman is actually... She kind of looks young, so that's... Ooh. That seems strange to me.
But supposedly she isn't, otherwise she wouldn't be making porn.
Yeah, well that's it. And, all my pedo friends will be very happy to find out that she is of age. Yeah.
Okay.
That goes out to you. I'm not saying your name, but yeah.
I'm sure...
You know, that's for you.
Yeah. Anyway, back to Australia and not small boobs.
Love you, Sarah.
not at all. Calling out her name. Apparently, there have. Amused me. Well, amused may not necessarily be the right word, but between 1994 and 2014, Australia banned 50 games, and in the past 4 months. It has banned 220 online games.
Yeah, that's very interesting.
It has refused classification. It has refused classification.
Yes, and this is with the introduction. We very recently, I think, free speech advocates have been fighting to get an adult rating for video games, and the rating people, whoever these people are, whoever makes them in charge,
I think they're called politicians.
They're not even politicians. No one elects them. They're just on a council for some reason.
Oh, okay.
And,
This sounds like a secret cabal.
It is a secret cabal. It's a secret cabal of very concerned citizens. It's like a worried mothers group.
Yeah, it's succumbers.
And, that's not an intended slur against mums. Many of my favorite people are mums, including my mum. But it's one of those very concerned Monday. Citizens groups that, it's like, Dungeons and Dragons are going to cause Satanism in the kids. Yeah. Anyway, so these people will say, well, you know what? Red blood is bad. We want green blood. Because that'll stop.
I used to refer to them no more as Columbine. AOL soccer moms.
AOL?
AOL online. Because, if you ask somebody, if you're having a discussion with somebody back in the 90s, you were like, do you use AOL? Like, people, like the precursor to social justice warriors, the way to tell if someone was a social justice warrior back then is you'd be like, do you use AOL? And they're like, yes. And you're like, you are not worth my time.
You don't even use the real internet. You're using America Online internet. I mean,
she's not
freak.
American. She's not even American.
You installed the internet using a CD-ROM that everyone else uses for coasters and frisbees.
Exactly.
Like that was a massive troll. You weren't meant to actually use that disc in a disc drive.
They still make money. I think it's amazing. There are people right now still using American Online.
I think they still make money because they were purchased by a big company. I can't remember which one, and so they're basically probably just Google. Using the name or something like this.
They still make money from the subscriptions to America Online.
No, they don't.
Yes, they do. You could look it up.
Yeah. Sometimes grandmas have to use the internet to complain about things that they've never heard of. That's what the point of that is.
Actually, I'd say that grandmas are pretty nice people online. They tend to
grandmas.
Be kind.
Well, how come they keep commenting on every single one of my photos on Facebook in caps?
That's different.
Explain that, John.
It's because you're
is that
hot
what nice people
grandmas?
Do?
You're just hot to grandmas. That's why they comment on
They talk in all caps. They don't use any punctuation. They talk as if no one else can read what they're writing. What are they doing?
Well, they probably can't read what they're writing. That's why they have to talk in caps.
Old phobia now. Hashtag old phobia.
Yeah. Free speech gate with dissing mums and old people.
And grandmas.
Just to balance that up, I also think Ben Kuchera is...
there you go.
Yeah, there you go.
Be careful.
That's a very nice koala that you're drawing there, Patrick. Is it? That's very nice.
Yeah,
I like
definitely.
That.
It's a very happy koala.
Make sure it's got fangs, like in real life.
Yeah. How do you feel about the continuation of IPs without the original creators, such as Dragon Ball, Star Trek, Star Wars, Stargate? Like, what would you think if Square continued Xenogears despite the original character working for Monolith in existence of the Sony Theater? But, well, here's the thing. When you're creating a series, like a video game series, it's not one person anymore. Like, you can say the original creator... But really what you're doing is you're building a brand. And
I need to go for a sec. My dog is getting very nervous and he needs to leave the room.
When you're creating something like that, you're usually creating it for a company that is basically paying your way for you to be creating this thing to begin with. Like, it wouldn't exist without that capital. And there is a lot of talk of, you know, creators creating or retaining some of their rights, but at the same time you have to consider that if the company owns it, they do have that right to continue without you. And I mean, sometimes it's in your contract that like they will continue the series whether you choose to do it or not, but you still usually get paid. Usually you still get money from that,
exactly.
And it's your choice whether you continue it or not. They will continue it without you if you choose not to.
Basically, Jen is saying, screw the fans, get money.
Well, no, not that necessarily, just that actually for the sake of the fans, if something, God forbid, happens to the creator, like, for example, Jason... even though I had a major, major part in creating all the characters for Seedscape and, you know, we made a lot of things together, if something, God forbid, were to happen to me, he needs to be able to continue that franchise without me.
In a way, the art we create is bigger than just us.
Right.
Once it's been out of ourselves... It becomes its own thing in a way. So the creator, the original creator, deserves a respect about the fact that he or she is the original creator, definitely. But the art in itself becomes its own property, its own chemistry, kind of. Also, I'd like to add the fact that sometimes big companies are assholes and kind of force small creators to lose their rights and all that. But
Ultimately, they make that choice, though. Like, they could choose to build up that series on their own and spend the time and the money. It's a trade-off, right?
They definitely help. The thing is, publishers and producers and all that, they're supposed to participate in the creation. They're supposed to give the right tools to a talented creator to be able to create something right. And in a way, if the creator hadn't been able to create what they created without the help of producers, publishers, etc., in a way, can we really say that the publishers didn't participate in the creation? They participated.
And marketing people absolutely do. Like, if you look at a lot of these people's unfinished work, it does not look the way that it is distributed. Like, even if you look at somebody like Adventure Time, you look at his actual drawings of Adventure Time, they are not polished pieces of work. They are scribbles and doodles, and they're not things that anybody would really want. And, you know, as much as people have the whole, screw publishers, yada yada, capitalism, copyrights are terrible, when you die you should lose everything. It's just...
I feel like you do lose
everything. We are looking down on the work of a lot of people that contributed to make something popular. And, if something happens to me and, Sprout is an international brand, there may be a lot of people's paychecks counting on that IP to continue to exist. And for someone to say, I should have access to this thing because you're dead, I mean, that gives not only gives people a lot of, reason to murder you and have you bumped off, it also hurts the people that have contributed to your stuff later in life that may want to continue working for the company after you're gone. And if your whole existence relies on something I created, you have a problem that has nothing to do with me. if you're relying on My Little Pony fan art for a living, that's your choice, but you can't be like, oh, well, F you, it should go back to public domain so I can make money off of this thing I had no hand in, and screw all your employees and loyal people that helped you throughout the years. I understand after maybe, I agree with the 75-year expiration because I think that's two generations and those people should have found something else, to deal with after that point.
So, but really, things like just, perhaps Lord of the Rings, I suppose that's not 75 years yet, but...
Oh, but that's a bit different because it's such a huge thing. America basically finds ways every time to just say, oh, well, we want this money for even longer, so we're going to make it, I think, 90 years, and it's going to be 90 years after the death of
the last Disney legislation.
The thing is, though, if it's still making money and if it's still an industry like Disney and things like that, people do not realize, something does not become more valuable when it enters the public domain. It loses its value inherently as employment.
I can't fully agree with that. I think that sometimes, of course, there is the idea of 70 years after the creator's death, and I understand that, and I definitely see the value in it, and I support it. But I still think that sometimes things need to be kind of let go. The fact of going public domain is a way of saying, okay, this was a thing, and now it's everyone's. Now it's not just it's not owned anymore. It's something that everyone can enjoy, everyone can work on. That is just the work of humanity. Now it's humanity's. It's any human being is allowed to work on this and to make this theirs. Just like kind of a little tale that you heard when you were a kid. Anyone can work on what's the name of this little slut? Little Red Hood. That's the name. Little Red Hood. That's her name, isn't it?
Red Riding Hood.
Yeah.
Red Riding Hood.
I'm sorry. I didn't know I didn't remember the English name. And that's something that everyone knows. That is part of not just public domain, but public knowledge, public consciousness in a way. And so it's important that this is and this remains something that is everybody's. And at some point...
Writing is a little bit different because... There are easier ways to do derivative works of writing, and you know, we have like the 20 basic stories, and regardless of how you shuffle them around, there's not that many plot lines and things that appeal to people. It's the same with music.
Yeah.
But I'm thinking more like if you need the exact depiction of Mickey Mouse for your life to be complete and for you to be able to profit from it.
I see what you mean.
You have an issue that goes beyond copyright.
Yeah, be more than just Mickey Mouse, definitely.
Right. It's and the thing is, I can make a mouse, my own mouse, and I can profit off of that mouse. And
no, you can't,
can draw Mickey
because
Mouse.
Disney is going to sue you. If you ever make a mouse character, they're going to sue you.
No, and they failed. That's the thing. People keep saying that, but they have failed 7 out of 8 times.
Oh, I didn't know
to
that.
Sue people. So, and they've actually stopped because they are losing so much from trying to do that. The thing is, though, is I can draw Mickey Mouse for free. You can draw Mickey Mouse for free. You can put it out for free. You can share it for free. There's nothing anybody can do about that. The only time it matters is if you're trying to make money off of it. And, you know, if you're trying to make a career off Mickey Mouse, what are you doing? You know, and I totally get the likeness thing, like some of that likeness stuff. You know, it gets ridiculous, but we've really reined that in.
You got to get rid of Dead Mouse. I mean, him using ears is disgusting.
And we'll see if they lose that one too, right? But let's be real here. Dead Mouse was using Mickey Mouse as a parody for his show. Like, let's not mince words here and say that he was not using it, because he totally was. That was the original intention.
I don't remember that.
Yes.
Oh, was it? Okay. Never heard of that.
So, it's just... There are definitely legitimate complaints. Absolutely.
Let me keep drawing.
But, yeah, I know. I'll get to that in a minute. Sorry. It really drives me crazy when people are like, I literally had a longtime friend basically say, you know, fuck you and your copyrights. I should get whatever you have when you die, and it should be mine, and fuck your employees and everybody that worked for you or helped you in your life. Their jobs are gone now because too fucking bad. I get to draw a sprout and screw you.
Yeah, that's adorable.
You know, like, it's just people can't ever come to some agreement on it. And it's the same with the TPP thing. Like, I totally get what the people are saying. But the people who are like, oh, my God, this hurts small artists, you know, it's the drug patents concern me far more, because the reality is that now if you copyright your work, even as a small artist in the U.S., it would also be copyrighted in China and anyone else who is in the TPP. So that actually does not hurt our small-time artists. I get what they're saying in other ways, but that specific part is not correct. And I really am tired of the EFF fear-mongering and not using the facts to... Because there are enough facts there to hate it.
Exactly. I think
and
the TPP...
don't need to make shit up. Like, the fact that, like, third world countries will not be able to make their own versions of drugs without going through the U.S., that's dangerous.
Yeah, that's fucking terrible.
That's scary. So, I get the concerns about copyright and royalties and being able to sue ISPs overseas. I get that. But let's focus on the fact that they're trying to take medications away from people in third world countries first, and we can deal with the rest later.
I think we don't need other arguments. I think just that is enough to say, okay, goodbye TPP.
Exactly.
So for those unfamiliar, including myself, what exactly is
TPP? It's a bill that's being passed, or it's about to be passed in the U.S.
Partnership. No, it's more of a UN thing.
A UN deal, sort of like a treaty between nations, I suppose.
Exactly, yeah. And there are things that I understand what they're trying to do, but what else is snuck in there is so terrible that I don't want it. Even for the protections in China, I do not, like, it's not worth it for all the other stuff.
Yeah, it's something basically to give even more power to control pretty much anything they feel like controlling, to governments and institutions and this kind of stuff. It's a bit vague how I'm explaining it, but that's the issue as well. And that's part of the issue, in that it's so secretive and secret and complicated. And it's complicated partly because since it's so complicated, few people are going to understand it. I doubt that myself and that I myself understood it really all that much anyway. Because it is so complicated and over convoluted.
Then they do that purposely because then they can sneak in bad things with good things and all of that bad stuff.
Yeah, that's how politicians work as well. Fucking politicians. I'm an anarchist. I'm not worried.
Another thing is, if you're nice to, this goes back to the thing before, if you're nice to artists and you talk to them like Dan did with us, we're pretty cool about things. So, but if you come at us and are like, fuck you, I'm making a t-shirt, and if you don't like it, you can shove it up your ass, my rights, you know, that's not going to go over well for you. It just doesn't. Be nice to people, be cordial, understand primary and secondary copyrights, and work together with people, and we don't really need the government to be constantly intervening on this shit, you know, if you have that. If you have etiquette and you talk to other people, and this is how the ESRB worked. It's just basically they were like, okay, if we don't deal with this ourselves, the government is going to deal with it, and they are going to do a terrible job. So let's talk to each other and deal with the problem before they do.
Exactly. We have to understand. We have to understand what the issue actually is instead of just being afraid of what the problem seems like. I don't know if that was English, what I just said. I wanted to mention something else about to go back to the Australia ban. I'm sorry, I'm going to be mean to your country again, Dan.
Oh, really?
Proud and proud country. The fact is, I was like everyone. I was looking at this and thinking, "Ah, Australia, you so crazy." And
but the 200 games, like, what games are they?
Exactly, that's the thing.
Like, I heard that apparently that a lot of them are just little piece of crap mobile games that no one gives a damn about anyway.
Exactly, that's the thing. All of a sudden, when you find out that nearly all of them are not necessarily terrible, but at the very least not even
shovelware.
Worth knowing about, it changes in your head. It's, oh, well, then it's not such a big deal. But... Is it less of a big deal if the fact that is mediocre is enough to make you feel like, no, don't keep it. It's fine if it's censored or if it's lost. Does mediocrity warrant indifference towards censorship?
Well, honestly, no. I think you got that's part of standing up for free speech is standing up for stuff that you don't like.
Mm.
I do not care that those things got banned, but I don't want them banned either.
It's like
if that makes sense.
Definitely.
It's kind of like with the Reddit thing. Like when that fat people hate thing got banned, I laughed. I did not care that it got banned, but at the same time, I didn't want it banned. Like I wasn't out there campaigning against it for any reason. Mm-hmm. The same way, I'm not even.
Yeah, I would laugh if is it Coontown is one of the racist subreddits that's still up? Yeah, yeah. So
I don't know.
If they banned that off Reddit, I would also laugh. But at the same time, I'm not out there campaigning against it because honestly, I don't care. You know, it's somewhere I don't need to go. It's not in my face.
Just so everybody knows, in case some people aren't aware, Reddit for the past few weeks has been hit with quite a bit of over-control from the admins. and basically anything that is warranted too offensive and too wrong to be allowed is just closed off. And there have been several subreddits, basically groups on Reddit, specific topics on Reddit. I don't go on Reddit, and I hate Reddit. I don't like the place. So a lot of those groups, of those subreddits, have been flat-out banned, which caused a lot of outrage. And that's pretty funny, because Fat People Hate, it was a subreddit about mocking fat people. It got banned, and like 5 minutes later, there was Fat People Hate 2, that was made, and there were dozens of thousands of people who followed it like the next minute, and it had a huge effect, and then it got banned too, so they made Fat People Hate 3 or something like this. So this again became huge, and then they went to 8chan, and then they it has the worst effect possible, basically giving them even an even louder voice, and that's quite representative of the issue also of free speech. If you force someone to shut up, they will only try to scream.
You have to apply more force until you get to the point where, well, maybe it's not worth shutting these people up.
Yeah, maybe just fucking maybe let them speak. Just speaking. If they did evil stuff, like actually putting
legal
people
things?
On fire. What?
If they put people in danger, fair enough.
Putting people's lives or livelihood in danger, yeah. I understand at the very least, but they're just talking and they're shit-talking. They're assholes, sure, but that's okay, let them fucking be assholes. Like, assholes are just that. They're assholes. You just put on some pens and they're not there anymore. Or you just watch the people from the front and you don't have to see those assholes. that was a fucking awesome analogy. I mentioned I was a writer at the beginning of the stream. I think
I loved it because of the wordplay. I mean, you know, you're right. You don't have to see them from the front. It's
this is so fucking profound, dude. Oh, I am a genius. Anyway, sorry. What was the name of this terrible movie? This terrible American movie that came out.
Room.
What?
Sorry, you said terrible movie. I said The Room.
No, that's a very funny movie. No, I meant an actually pretty mediocre movie that came out last year. I think it was last year or this year. It was about murdering North Korea's leader.
The Interview.
Yeah, that's right, The Interview. And it got Sony got hacked by North Korea, and they said, do not release this movie or else. And it was a shit movie. It was really a movie that has...
I haven't seen it.
The actors were very mad.
Like, North Korea hacking, like, seriously, like, I don't know. I have a hard time believing that.
I don't think it was really... North Korea, and honestly, I wouldn't even put it past Sony for pulled that whole thing off as a publicity exercise, because I didn't know that movie was coming out. I had no idea that movie was coming out.
You mean that was quite a great marketing ploy indeed. But I'm not gonna go conspiracy on this and think, oh, it's actually Obama himself who called Kim Jong Un to send threats to the US or whatever else.
That's the thing. I don't care too much about that conspiracy theory. Regardless,
there was a huge uproar about the fact that Sony backed down and said, "Well, we are not going to release this movie after all," and and a lot of people decided to support this movie and watch this movie just because it was a pride in yes, you are allowed to make this movie, and it was a lame movie. Really, it had nothing interesting for it. It's not very funny. It's not very interesting. It's not very well made. It doesn't have great actors. It doesn't have great.
You don't tell that to. Seth Rogen is going to tweet very angry things.
Oh, Jesus Christ! If this guy who is a fucking Hollywood movie star tweets as some loser on Twitter, like, what the hell? This guy is a fucking loser if he tweets at me. Like, why would he tweet at me? I'm no one. but anyway,
he's got to protect his brand by getting angry on Twitter. That's how you do it.
Getting angry at someone who's no one. That's the fucking amazing. Sure makes him look very wise and interesting as a man. Well, I do hope he's not going to. I do hope he's not going to ever even hear me shit talk him. I don't even hate the guy. I don't even hate the guy even as an actor. It's just in this movie he was. Not very worth it. Like,
I'm gonna tell Seth Rogen that he's gonna be very upset. I'm gonna post a link to this stream when it's finished. I'm gonna post it to him, and I'm gonna timestamp it, and he's gonna know, that John did this, and I'm gonna tell him how to get to you as well. I'm gonna tell you about your love for baguettes.
Okay. I do hope he does. I do.
Seth Rogen's going to tweet at you saying that baguettes suck. It's going to be great.
That's actually a great segue to another... is it segue? Segue? How do you pronounce it?
Segue.
Like, why segue. Would you write it... Why would you write it like that if you pronounce
segue?
It like this?
Well, I don't know. Word should really be re-spelled phonetically at this point.
Well, maybe in game.
English is just a... English and most Germanic languages is just absolute cluster of crazy.
We're getting a bit.
Everything's spelt wrong. It's just disgusting.
We're getting a bit behind on people's comments, I think.
Someone wants to talk about the Draw Prophet Muhammad contests.
Does someone want to comment on it before I do?
No.
It's something quite close to me since I'm French and what happened with Charlie Hebdo and it's something very complicated because in a way I'm a bit I'm intensely biased about this. I was extremely upset at the Charlie Hebdo shootings. I spent an entire week just crying every single time I even thought about this. It was terrible. It was fucking awful. The thing is, the issue goes further than even free speech. The idea is, in France, we're allowed to mention anything we want. And I'm perfectly aware of all the people. That's very amusing. I'm using it not the right way. It's more pissing me off that I'm using it. I had a few arguments, and I'm stupid for having arguments on Twitter. I know I am stupid, but I was upset. I was emotional. I had arguments with non-French people who were swearing on their life that Charlie Hebdo was a white supremacist newspaper. Charlie Hebdo is a communist. It's not. Communist, namely communist, but it's got communist ideologies and all that, so it's lefter than left. So no, it's not white supremacists. One of the people who got killed was Wonaski, who was born in Turkey. So he's not a white supremacist. I doubt he was. And you had Sharp as well, who had worked quite a bit with SOS Racisme, which is basically the French Association Against Racism. And so it's unlikely that a man who was an activist against homophobia and the far right parties and against racism and all that, I doubt that someone like that would end up being a white supremacist. But those people made jokes. And those people made jokes at the expense of people who didn't want to be joked about. And the issue is that when you want to be part of a society that considers that everyone is welcome as long as you understand how culture works here, you have to understand that, yes, this is how it works here. They make fun of Jews, they make fun of Christians, they make fun of women, they make fun of men, they make fun of the far right, they make fun of the far left, they make fun of people, and they shit talk, and they make very harsh jokes. And I didn't even like Charlie Hebdo all that much. I found them a bit too cheeky and too snarky sometimes. Charlie Hebdo is a bit too far left for me. they made jokes because some people were dumb or were saying dumb stuff or were doing dumb things, and so they made jokes about it. And so if you want to be part of the French culture, in this example it's about France, if you want to be part of France, you have to adhere to the fact that, yes, we are going to make joke of your communities and what you like and what you feel you are and your identities. We are. And we're going to present it sometimes in terrible ways, and we're going to openly talk about it and make silly gags or movies or books, etc., saying bad stuff about what some people in your communities do. Whether you're Muslim or Jewish or a woman or a politician or whatever, or poor or old or young or whatever, if there is a reason to make a joke about you, we are going to make a joke about you. And the issue is there are a lot of people, and this has a lot of, to do also with religion and culture beyond just free speech and all this, and there are a lot of people who do not adhere with the idea, no, in my culture, you do not make jokes about us. I do not accept that you make jokes that you take us non-seriously. I do not accept that you are not allowed to do it. And sadly...
Well, yeah, in some cultures, honor is very, very important. Not my culture. Personally, I don't give a damn about honor. But for some people, it is very important that you have honor. And if someone insults that, you have to return...
Yeah. You're not insulting just their culture, sort of you're insulting them. It feels like you have to.
You have to stand up and say, you have to give some sort of response to show that you're not, you're not weak. You're not taking this lying down.
But for example, it's not even something. I'm not even criticizing Muslims or whatever else. That's not the point. Because for example. Yeah. For example, in France, you had so they made it's years old, by the way, the Mohammed's caricatures. They are years old. It happened a lot of a long time ago already, and there were Muslims who went to court to say they did something bad, and that I perfectly accept. You are using this society's tools to make yourself right, to make things right again, to try to explain things, to be just, to bring back justice. And they went to court, and I understand that. And they lost. Ultimately, they lost because France said, yes, they made a joke at your expense, and they're allowed to do that. But those people, they are... Muslims who dislike the joke, which I perfectly understand, but they did so, and they expressed it so in a perfectly acceptable and respectable way. They used justice, they used the law, and not murdering people in cold blood. Some of them who weren't even working in Charlie Hebdo, and so that's the thing. You have a choice between either trying to write your own paper and explain why why this is wrong, this is right, or you can go to court and say this wasn't fair, this was fair, or you murder everyone. And it's pretty upsetting to me that there were so many people, mostly American, to be fair, but it's America, who immediately went to the defense of the killers and said, yes, they did that, but they had a good reason to do it. And that's a bit upsetting to me. No, they didn't have a good reason to do it. They didn't. So, yeah, that's my take on it. I don't know if you have anything to add, but that's something pretty close to me.
I don't know. I think specifically about the Draw Muhammad contest things. Yeah, I think I'd agree completely. You know, with free speech and that sort of thing. So I wonder, is there anything to the devil advocates? You know, like, let's do another opinion. What about the idea that people are intentionally provoking attacks? Yeah. You know, is that responsible? Because you can stand up and say, free speech, we should be able to do this. Honestly, I don't have any reason to draw Muhammad or whatever. But is that responsible on a society-wide level? Is it responsible to be provoking what you could possibly be an attack that requires police or military resources or anything like that? Is that responsible, knowing that there are going to be people who will never respect any kind of free speech?
You don't have a responsibility to be nice. You don't have a societal responsibility to be nice to other people.
That's not what I mean. I mean, like, as in a societal responsibility just to not waste, like, not to increase the amount of violence that people have to deal with. You know, that kind of position. What do you think about that?
I don't think you have any responsibility for other people's violence at all. Okay. Like,
I'm not guilty of what someone else is going through.
Right. If I draw Sprout and Sprout enrages someone to the point of wanting to kill me, I can't really be held responsible for them wanting to kill me, because, like, when you get into that, you get into the, oh, well, this person was killed because they had too much money, or this person was killed for begging on the street because it offended my personal sensibilities, and it's just like, that line of thought never stops, so you have to side with the line of personal responsibility and, you know, you're responsible for your feelings. And, you know, I'm pretty respectful of other people's religions. Like, I wouldn't personally draw that sort of stuff, but I would never make the excuse that, oh, they were triggered into killing people, because you literally don't have that right, especially when you're not in, you're in French society. You are not in, you know, the society where that is the dominant, you know, ruling religion. You are in a society where you are expected to be part of French culture, not your culture. So you can bring your culture there, but you have to respect where you are.
There's, I don't know if you have this saying in, as well in English. In French, we have a phrase. It's my rights end where other people's rights begin.
Right. We have it. My rights end at the tip of my nose, or something like that.
It's a bit of a touchy subject. It goes way beyond just free speech. It goes way beyond that. It touches on religion and politics and culture.
It affects people's safety as well.
Yeah, in a way, but yeah. I think if we all agree that, yes, there are people who are going to dislike who I am, and that's fine, their safety won't be an issue. If we all grow up with the idea of, okay, someone will hate me, and that's fine. Let them fucking hate me, or let they make fun of me. It's fine. Let them do that, and I'll keep being myself. I'll keep doing what I like doing. And that's all that matters, I'd assume. Anyway, we've gone long enough on this topic. Also, guys, just as a warning, Jen has a huge hailstorm outside of her home, so sometimes her mic might get cut off or something like that, just as a warning.
Okay. All right.
It's actually kind of scary. I can't see outside because it's so much hail.
Woof.
I hope you're okay, dear.
Okay, I think someone is talking about anti-criticism. So it's not particularly free speech, I suppose, but it's... let's see if I can read the question. I don't know if you've experienced this as well, but when I was young, I posted art on various forums that were supposed to help draw better. What I found is that there seemed to be this unspoken rule that you only praise the work or stay silent. What do you think about this, and how do you think this anti-criticism culture affects the quality of art and artists?
Basically, it's an anti-criticism is being treated like a child all your life. Children aren't criticized for their art because they're children. Of course, they're bad at art. They can't draw because, of course, they don't know how anatomy works, how proportions work, how all of this works. Of course, they can't write because they don't know any stories besides the rabbit ate a carrot. And it's not even a bad story per se. It's just a childish story that doesn't go further than that. And so, of course, you don't criticize it to the levels of what adults produce. But at the same way, you're not going to say that it's the most amazing drawing you've ever seen if it's just poop. You know, they drew poop and yeah, that's it. No, try to go further. Try to push themselves to be better at what they're doing. To, hey, you know, you could do something that is so incredible, it will blow my mind and all this. The issue with anti-criticism is I don't want to grow up. This is what it means. Treat me like a child because the way I am right now, I'm content with, and I don't want to get better at it. And in a way, that's fine for people who don't want to get better at any art they're into. Sure, remain at this small level of, I'm good on this. But if people want to, aside from the fact that everyone is allowed to criticize you, if they feel like criticizing you, I don't like what you did. Sure, okay, don't like what I did. There's also the fact that if you want to get better, you can't you can't demand a lack of criticism. Otherwise, it actually means that you're Andrew Dobson, that you want to remain a child forever. And that's important to not remain a child forever because you want to grow up as a creator, as yourself. And since art is supposedly an expression of yourself, of your self, in the most essential meaning of the word. That means that you don't want yourself to grow up if you're demanding that people don't let your art grow up either. Although, to be fair, if you go on YouTube communities or whatever else, sometimes criticism isn't criticism. It's just people spouting stuff at you. So,
I mean, harmful opinions, just talking crap about, like Tim Tams. That's not criticism. That's just, honestly, it's wrong.
It's just objectivity.
Yeah. And it's disgusting. And it shouldn't be allowed.
Yeah, we should ban criticism of Tim Tams.
Well, it's just not ban it, but just let people know. Well, you're wrong, so if you enjoy being wrong, you can...
So criticizing my criticism of Tim Tams. Okay, I get you.
You can continue being wrong, or you can join the Tim Tam Master Race.
I think that, you know, if you don't see value in criticism, that's fine. I prefer to share resources with people for them to get better rather than being like, oh, you know, that hair, it's crazy and, you know, no one will like it. And it's just not... Because, and it's the thing, it's the same thing with, like, game design. I tend to operate on feelings, like, the feelings people are giving about it rather than just the straight-up critique, because unless they're in the same skill level, they really can't give you a viable solution, which is kind of why you hang out with other artists and not just, you know, post your stuff on Tumblr and be like, praise me or shut up! You know, it's just... If you're looking to improve, that's just not really the place to go.
Yeah, I think there was a very famous example of this. I think it got on to Encyclopedia Dramatica. But this particular artist, I won't say her real name. I'll just say, I think one of her handles was Snape Stenoga. Have you ever heard of that one?
No, I never heard of it.
She used to be called Snape Snogger. She liked drawing a lot of Harry Potter fan art, particularly, you know, Snape stuff. And anyway, you know, she'd post things on DeviantArt, and most people would just say, oh, you know, that's nice, and you know, it was okay. Like, you know, she's not a terrible artist. But you know, you could see things that she could improve. You know, this anatomy could be better, whatever. And one time, she posted on a more serious forum, inverted commas serious, where you get serious critique. You post there to get people ripping your piece to shreds, so you know which little bits that you can still tighten up and make better. She goes there, expects it to be like DeviantArt, where you know people, if they don't like it, they just don't usually comment, and she was absolutely devastated. Absolutely devastated. They're like, what the hell is this? How can a male be pregnant? How can, you know, talking about her characters, like, oh, you know, this, the belly button's in the wrong spot. Why don't you draw noses? Oh, this nose is too big. Why have you done this? And she just could not handle it at all. And that may be something to do with her particular temperament. But if you want to get better, and if you post in an area where generally people give harsh critique or, you know, constructive criticism, you've got to be able to handle your babies being killed, basically. You know, you may love this character that you've drawn for, you know, since you were 9, but if a wider audience looks at it and thinks, well, this could be better and you should change this. Like, if you only want to draw for yourself, that's fine. If you want to draw for others and you want other people to enjoy your art, you should definitely listen to other people when they tell you,
the rest of the world,
I don't like this. I mean, for instance, you could draw whatever terrible art you want, and or you know, even just improve at your own pace. You know, maybe you're not looking for serious critique. That's fine. But if you really want to get better, and especially if you want an audience, especially if you want to make money doing art, you have to listen to what people say. You have to. I mean, obviously, you know, take into account what their skill level is, what they know about art. Not necessarily to write people off, but if someone who is a lay person, you know, just says, I don't like this piece of art, you're going to listen to them as well, because you know, your consumers, your audience is not all going to be, it's not all going to be big fine art critics. So, you know, listen to the fine art critics so you can tighten up, you know, how you render things or you know, do things better on a technical level or whatever. But also keep in mind what any other person would think. I think that's like a disconnect between some art movements. I'm not saying who, modern art. They just have a profound disconnect with the regular audience. So Like, even, like, I'm not a huge, big, amazing art critic or whatever. I have no reputation or anything. But I look at, mm-hmm. like, I just as a, on an artist level, I look at modern art and I think, this is rubbish. this is all garbage. You haven't made something that looks good. Like, that's what is most important to me in art, is that you make something that looks good. But a lot of modern art is about ideas, and mm-hmm. art critics will be all about ideas. A lot of art criticism is infatuated with ideas. Mm. But the layperson will just look at this, something like Duchamp's water fountain and go, well, this is crap. And honestly, I have the same opinion as that layperson. But an art critic will go, oh, well, you just don't know what this is saying about art.
They understand.
Well, and that's fair. That's a fair comment to say. They don't understand what it's saying about art. But I do, and I still think it sucks. Well, I understand its place in art history. I don't like it.
To be fair, contemporary art, with what you're talking about and all, there was a principle at the start. It was basically, simply, we want the relationship of the audience is part of the art piece, in a way. Like, the fact that they see it and they react that way is a part of the creation in itself. And it's an interesting way of doing things, and it's very modernist and all this.
I'm sorry, but people who view art are over, and they don't have to be your audience.
There's two things that are very important with criticism. It's the reason it makes you grow. Art is about expressing yourself, but art is about expressing yourself to other people. And so the thing is, criticism is about teaching you that there are more critics than yourself, and teaching you how to criticize yourself the right way, in a way automatically. So I'm writing something and, oh, that's not punchy enough. I want to make people cry. It's not tear-jerking enough. Or I want it to be a bit funny, but I feel this like rhythm and all that. And I don't even need to go to someone else to criticize it, to know what's wrong with it or what's so good with it, etc. This is supposed to teach me to have kind of the automatism of criticism. But there's also the fact that when I make art, which I want other people to read, watch, etc., I have to understand the fact that there are other people who have different emotions, and I have to understand how emotions themselves work. And the rest of the world is the rest of the world. It's not just me. So something that would make me cry wouldn't make someone else cry. And I have to realize that and grasp why this wouldn't work, this would work, this would work in this very specific situation, etc. Criticism is about teaching me how I think, and about understanding others. It's about myself and my relationship to others as well. So it's teaching me to mind read, in a way. When someone criticizes me, that they teach me how to read someone else's mind. And that's very important to be an artist, I believe.
I think, too, like, if you just want to make art in a vacuum, that's fine. If it's you, it's fine. But, like, the ones that get me are the people that are like, I deserve to make money from this, whether you appreciate it or not. Like, people have forgotten what money is. Money is, I like this, and I want it to exist and for there to be more of it. That when it comes to art, that's what you're saying. So... Mm-hmm. Making something and then being like, oh my god, people won't pay for it. Let's make the government force them to pay for it because I should, exist as an artist. It's like, great, you can exist as an artist without money for that. You can always work another job and put out art that no one likes. That's up to you.
Are we possibly being inspired by Tale of Tales and then...
No, let's not bring that up.
You don't want to talk about that?
I've heard it, but this is a sentiment.
Maybe, they say they're making art, and I believe them. I say, yes, okay, this is... But, you've got to appreciate that some people just don't like that art. Like, is it...
That's part of art, by the way. Like, part of art is also that people won't like it as well. That's
yeah,
the point.
Yeah, for me, the question of whether something is art or not is very boring to me. I don't understand the allure. That kind of thinking is just very boring. I want to know whether the art is good, whether it is interesting, whether it speaks to me. I have not played Sunset. I will not be able to speak from it personally, but some people I know, Mars Cat on Twitter has been live tweeting some sessions of playing with it, and it seems to be, her opinion, very pretentious and
It's not even just that terrible. It's bad.
Trying very, to sound very deep and
self-important. It's too self-important. It's too much about the creator and only the creator's mind and all that. It's not even terrible at all. It's not terrible in the slightest. It's just, hey, look at me. And they want a mom. Mom, look at my drawing and say that it's beautiful. And because she's your mom, of course she'll say it's beautiful. She's your fucking mom. Of course she will say it's beautiful.
Well, there's the target market. The target market for Sunset is Tale of Tales mums, and I hope they appreciate it. I hope they really like that.
That's exactly right.
Jen wants to rubbish Tale of Tales. Go ahead, Jen.
No, it's this trend of where we have this, you know, right to exist, this right to a job, right to money, right to all these other things, and it's like, you do have those things. They're called social welfare, and then those are fine. We need those programs, but you don't have the right to get extra money on top of that for what you feel like you should. And it's just like, I don't know where we cross that line into, not only am I have the right to, you know, food, housing, all of these other things, but I have the right to feel good and be paid money regardless of whether other people want that. That is literally like serving people coffee made with manure and being like, why don't you appreciate my manure coffee? Like, the government should force you all to drink this because, you know, I made it, and I, and this is the thing that bothers me. I spent so much time on this, and you don't like it. It's like, well, then you weren't effective, and that's what criticism is about. It's, was this effective? If, you know, if you post a piece of art and people are like, oh, this is disgusting, and that was your aim, you've been effective. You're still effective. People might not want to pay you for that, but you were effective.
Again, I want everybody to be my mom. My mom said it's good, so I want everybody to do like my mom.
Do you have a mom? Yeah. Like, do they have a mom fetish or what? Like, what is?
No, I'm going psychological.
Yeah, they do.
I'm being a shrink.
Yeah, well, I know you're using like Freud on them, but
Freud, what a hack.
The guy who wasn't raised by his mother commenting on people being sexually attracted to their mother. Good job.
That's exactly true. Like, using his own theories, that's projection. Projection.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah,
because he was raised by his nanny. So did he see his mum getting undressed one time, and he's like, oh.
It's
feelings.
You have to read some Freud. It's very interesting. It's not just garbage and all that. It has a lot of value. It explains a lot of things. It makes sense.
Let's be honest. He was afraid of ferns, and he wanted his mum. And I will dismiss him just as easily as that.
Other theories were okay, but anything that relates to his relationship with his mother, you're just like, no.
You're basing this all on yourself, man.
You know what's psychological? Like, it would be really ironic if he was the person to come up with such psychological projection, because, like, come on, man. I guess he would know, but...
Yeah. Since we're on the topic of fetishes...
We are.
Oh, fantastic
well,
segue.
You were talking about fetishes to your own mom, Oedipus complex, and all that.
I've got that. Yeah.
So that happened this week as well in on Twitter is there are a few adult hentai artists that got their accounts removed on Twitter. And so
right.
There's Oyari Yashito and Fatal Pulse. And Mikan Fuyuno and Eiichi Mudo. That's the ones. And they got their accounts banned, and they did make quite raunchy stuff. And the thing is, Fatal Pulse, for example, had 67,000 followers, and he got his account revoked anyway. And that's something that tends to happen quite a bit on social media, the idea to, no, this content is not fine. You can't have this content, even though the guy clearly had quite a bit of success. He had 67,000 people following him. No, that's still not worthy of being shared. Like you can't have this content on this.
And so I'm confused.
US law for that, though.
What is Twitter's idea about that sort of thing? Because there is porn being posted all over Twitter every single day, just by so many people. None of them are getting taken off, but this one artist is being taken off Twitter? I don't understand.
The thing is, my suspicion on this, it's merely suspicion, I'm not 100% sure, I didn't find any source on this. But my suspicion is that basically, when the right person complains about the content, it gets erased. If it's just someone complains about it, it's just porn, it's fine, etc. When this person says, "Hey, take it off the air," it gets taken off the air. And so I suppose that those artists made stuff, and someone saw this stuff and said, "That's terrible, that's awful. How can the Japanese ever do something so?" So repulsive and shameful.
The Japanese. At it again.
Then three instead of only two. And so they demand that it gets banned, and so it does.
Well, the thing is technically speaking, Twitter has to ban all of that stuff because their platform is 13+. Obviously, they're selectively doing this, but U.S. law, you have to have certain provisions in place to prevent people from seeing that stuff, depending on the
age. Get Ellen Powell onto it, make her CEO on Twitter as well, and clean up the internet.
Speaking of that and Twitter, I mean, like, as much as it would be nice if you could just post whatever and it would be kind of like viewer beware, there are certain laws in the United States, and technically, if you are paying for bandwidth and other people are on your site posting things that they either shouldn't be, or they are, you know, saying things that even you don't like, I mean, it's your responsibility as a server owner to dispose of that, it's not a freedom of speech issue because you don't have that on a private server, basically. Yeah. It's not a government-owned server, so it's not...
Yeah, so feel like I suppose it's... would you say it's more of a...
it's a consumer issue.
An unequal...
right.
Unequal... what would you call it? Can't think of the word. But,
you're the English-speaking guy. You know, you have more vocabulary than I do in English.
The things that bother me is that it's a false advertising issue for some of the stuff to me. Like with Reddit, it's like, oh my God, we're this open platform for discussion. You can discuss whatever you want, no matter what it is. Mm. And suddenly they're selectively enforcing.
Yeah.
They're right. And those are the kinds of things that bother me. Like, if you don't want to hear
so
the
pics
phrase,
of dead kids is still up there, isn't it?
Exactly. And you don't hear, like, you know, if I as a site owner say I don't want to hear the phrase A Lamau You know, that is your right. To as stupid as that is, you know, as a server owner, you have the right to ban that. As long as you're enforcing it equally, you know, and even then, like, it's still subject.
There's a consistency to your
right. Console. But as far as, like, they don't have to allow pornage, I just think it's weird that, like, there's some accounts that are still there and, like, like, I know it's very, very hard to manage this many accounts, but there are some that are, like, huge.
Mm,
and they've been there, and they're continuing to be there, and it's just like, okay, I understand you're not seeing all of them, and you can't possibly be expected to deal with all of them, but it's just weird that you're banning the fake people over the actual ones that are real people filling their lives with various objects.
You know what I find always amusing with Japanese porn hentai, is the fact that some of it is actually incredibly well drawn. Some of the art or the writing, even sometimes. I remember I read some hentai once, and I cried at the end. I was in fucking tears at the end. It was porn, and I was still crying. And
Link
it's still,
porn.
Like in Western porn, not like I'm really an expert in the field. all of a sudden I have a really rough throat.
what a liar!
But in Western porn, we tend to just have, hey, I have a sausage for you. Oh, how big is your sausage? Let's see how big it is. And that's pretty much it. That's all the writing there is. And even sometimes
someone go back and use that little section there as a recording. I want to post it on Twitter. Thanks.
In Japan, really, there is a huge culture about porn being part of art and culture as well. Like, this is really something important and relevant. And
Is that the case? Or is it more of like a private thing?
What do you mean by private?
I just mean, is it one of those things where it's privately, yes, it's very much a part of art and there's so many artists involved in it, but publicly it's very shameful to talk about.
They will have hentai artists working on kids' shows, whereas you could never do that in the West.
Is that open? Is that openly?
Yeah.
Rather, I just
wonder.
There are porn stars that star in kids' shows in Japan. Like, they don't really care as much.
Yeah, they seem to be rather fine with it. I'm convinced that there are hentai artists who are working as character designers on a few games. I might be entirely full of shit about that, but I do believe that.
Yeah, I'd have to ask someone who's native in, you know, living in Japan, because the impression I get is that it's very outwardly conservative.
Oh, I think that you're not going to talk about it in the street with just anyone or with politicians and all this, but that might simply be the notion of, everyone's aware that it's part of the culture, that it's there, and that you can accept this part of what you enjoy. There was this movie, Lost in Translation, Scarlett Johansson and Bill Murray, and at the beginning of the movie, you have a Japanese man in the subway reading hentai, mm-hmm. reading like openly, and he's fine with it. And I'm not entirely sure that his parents approve, but still, he does it openly, and no one's telling him, "Oh, what are you doing?" etc. Whereas if you did this in America, I'm not entirely sure that people would be really.
Some women actually reported a guy on a plane for that.
Oh yeah, but I think
really?
It was To be fair, if we're thinking of the same case, to be fair, it was a bit dumb of the guy. He was openly watching porn on his tablet, on a plane, and so yeah, of course you just don't do that. You just don't.
Of course not. I just thought it was funny that like.
But the thing is.
Oh, it's always funny.
apparently, she went really, really, really mad with it, and she was a big anti-porn activist, something like that.
Oh my goodness, a big activist against all the cartoon people being violated.
Yeah.
But just up there with the Josh and Toshes, keeping us, keeping all the fictional people safe.
Exactly. But the thing with Twitter and the hentai, that's part also of the free speech conversation. It's sometimes, yeah, there are sites where no, things are a bit in control, and not everything is allowed, and that's kind of how it is. And for example, we were talking about Muslims earlier on, and I totally understand if I went to a Muslim forum or image board or whatever. And if I said anything against Islam or whatever, they'd ban me, and I perfectly understand that, and I'd find them.
From a Muslim country?
What?
From a Muslim country, you're saying?
Exactly. If I posted a forum...
depending on the country, you might get more than a ban.
Mm. Yeah, sure.
Might get a stoning, might get thrown off a building, who knows?
Yeah. Oh, actually, there was this one guy who wrote a blog. I think it was in Egypt. He wrote a blog, and he criticized the government. And he received, 5,000 whippings, something like that?
Yeah, I'm not sure how many it is. It was quite a lot. And
basically, he's whipped him 50 times a day, because if he's whipped any more than that, he's at risk of dying. So he's given his 5,000 whippings. It's maybe not 5,000, it might be 1,000, but it's still a fucking lot. Even 10 is a fucking lot.
He's allowed to heal so they can keep doing
exactly. That's fucking terrible. Because he wrote a blog post, again, that's all he did.
Yeah.
So
But, you know, to be fair, and well, actually...
Well, actually...
No, and the thing is, like, I do believe in respecting, like, other people's private spaces. Like, if you do want to have a forum where, you know, it's not a requirement for you to be there, and you're like, oh, well, you don't like swearing on this forum, so it is my obligation to... fled this forum with swearing. Like, I don't really understand that. I understand if it's like a pull out the rug from under you situation, like I think a lot of this was. But I don't personally understand, like, being like, oh, this website that I never cared about before and I routinely call cancer is now acting like cancer. Here's a fit about it, and I'm just like, and I do think that there is some, I do agree with some people who are saying, you know, because of some of this, there are harassment laws being drafted based on some happenings that happen on certain sites, but it's not necessarily, usually if the site self-regulates really well, the law will kind of stay away. But if a lot of people start complaining about a company not handling this thing, then we start getting into law dog territory, and it's just, I don't think we should be making laws against things that are like, I don't have to be on this website if it makes me uncomfortable. Like, why is there no law that says that if you complain, like, you have to leave the website?
Yeah, exactly. Like, this wasn't meant for you, so just don't go.
Like, Twitter, like, I do agree that for business promotion and things like that, like, social media is slowly becoming a must. So it does suck when you, like, run a business and people are like, haha, I saw one of your opinions and I disagree, I'm going to kill you. You know, like, that's pretty horrible. But at the same time, I'm like... No, you're not. I live in the middle of nowhere in the Arctic, you know, north, and no, you're not. It's just, I think you have to balance your fear of things that are probably not going to happen with your need to be on a website.
Yeah. This makes me think of another thing that happened this week as well. It was I read it on BBC, BBC.com, and it happened in Great Britain. There was an opera. It was the opening night of William Tell at the Royal Opera House, and the thing is, the director decided to put a rape scene in the story, and the thing is, the audience started booing, and they openly booed and booed and booed until they got they got their message. We hate the fact that you dared to send. There was someone who commented, "Senseless, sensationalist Guillaume Tell, complete with gratuitous nude rape scene. Royal Opera House represents new nadir. Heads should roll." It's the Michael Arditi, the Sunday Express theater critic, and so he's a theater critic. That's how far he went with that, and so that's I think that's a bit on point with what you mentioned, Jen. The fact that those people paid to see they paid to see this show, to see this art piece, and they are upset that they were shown something, that they were forced to have emotion they weren't expecting to have.
Is this a new opera that was written, or is it a well-known?
No, it's quite old. I don't remember.
Right.
Let me look. No, apparently it's something that has existed for quite a while, but adapted it to the director.
Oh, has it been adapted in a different way to make it more offensive, or is that what's happened?
Oh, perhaps. He put a rape scene in it, and apparently he left it for quite a while, do expect that he was trying to be provocative. Let me look.
Yeah. So, are you making a point about them listening to their audience, or?
The opera is Italian director Damiano Micheletto's debut at the Royal Opera House. It's not the first time he has experienced protests from audiences. Apparently it's not the first time. He has been a very provocative director, apparently, in the past.
He likes rustling the jimmies.
He insisted he did not aim to scandalize. No, not at all. You have to provoke in a good sense. I want to provoke a reaction. I want to make the audience feel the emotions, the empathy with these characters and with this story. He said he did not have to give traditional audiences what they wanted. Tradition for me has to be like a trampoline, to jump to somewhere. It's not to drag you down. I try to be really clear with the audience. I try to be really honest with them, even if they don't like my ideas or they don't like the way I'm proposing them. He added, theater is not a temple. Theater is not a church. Theater is a place of freedom, of challenging, of emotions, of life. And I quite like how he's going with this. So I haven't seen the opera, obviously. He went with his own take on this story. And perhaps I'm wrong. Perhaps this is a new opera as well. But there aren't a lot of new operas nowadays. Anyway, he told his story the way he felt like telling it. And the thing is, the audience was forced through a painful emotion, because, of course, it is painful to see someone get raped. in a story or a movie or a book or whatever. It is painful. But they decided that the right way to react was to openly reject it during the show. If afterwards they criticize and they say it was misplaced, it put me, it made me uneasy, etc., I perfectly get that. But during the show, they wanted the opera to stop because the this wasn't it, and that is a bit strange to me. Like,
I know people who can't watch that stuff on TV, so they just like turn it off or they leave.
Yeah, and they could leave as well during the opera, by the way. They could just leave. But they openly demanded that it stops. Again, there's this theater critic who said heads should roll. He wants someone to be fired after that.
What?
Wow. So, whose free speech is getting impacted on here? Obviously, the audience is not happy with what the artist has made, and they're being very vocal about it. Should they shut up, or is their free speech important as well? Is it important that they're able to protest during a performance or not?
That's actually a very good question. Should they be allowed to voice their disappointment of the art piece? Or should the artist be more important than the? But the thing is, they
like,
can
should they, voice. Should they be quiet during the performance and talk later, or are they allowed to?
Personally,
voice
their
displeasure in the moment.
I might be biased because I'm an artist and I'm a writer, but I say if you dislike what you're seeing, you leave or you stay quiet until you can give your criticism. If I watch a movie and it's extremely painful and unbearable to me, I leave or I shut up, and once it's over, I say, well, that was fucking terrible. And it's the thing is, if you demand for it to stop, because they were booing, and they weren't booing so that the rape scene would stop, they were booing so that the opera would stop, even because that was so awful to show that, and the entire show suffered from it. But it's a very good question. I hadn't thought about that. But the thing is, both things can work together with the idea of, again, yes, you dislike that, and you're allowed to voice the fact that you dislike it, definitely. You're allowed to criticize it. But you have to allow this thing to exist as well. You have to allow this artist to happen, to take place. And if nobody goes to see the opera, well, that means that no one liked it, no one wanted to see it. I just found it. Indeed, it was a Rossini's opera. It was an opera written by Rossini, apparently.
Okay.
So it's an old opera, indeed. So
now, I think we've got a very limited amount of time left. Did you feel like going on for much longer? I've got an idea for a topic.
Again, it's just talking about this and that and
having
fun and shit-talking Australia, our friends. We didn't shit-talk Canada enough.
Honestly, they get so much from America. I don't even feel like I don't have any sort of desire to just badmouth Canada. I mean, they get so much crap from USA all the time. It feels like shooting a dead horse in a barrel. If I could mix two metaphors.
I enjoyed this stream. It was really nice. I do hope that people who were watching enjoyed it as well. Again, sorry for the lack of chat. That's a shame.
Oh, just disgusting. On a free speech stream as well.
Exactly.
No chat.
Don't hesitate to hit Starius again. His YouTube channel is Starius2, to the number.
YouTube.com/Starius2. Starius.
Two. Two. We're shilling for it.
Chill.
So that was quite nice. I'm glad we had this. I thank you a lot, Dan, for coming here.
Well, thank you very much.
That was nice talking to you and having your opinion and sharing your experience, your personal experience and your personal take and everything.
Tim Tams are very important to me.
Exactly. This is the most important message you had to share. I thank you, Patrick, a lot for your art and your patience and your time.
Thanks, Patrick.
Thanks a lot for what you did.
Are you drawing Fox? Are you drawing Star Fox?
obviously, thanks a lot, Jen, for participating and being there with me. I could never do anything without you, Jen.
or baguettes.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
You're They're so very important. I don't know if you understand, listeners. John is very upset if you badmouth baguettes and French cuisine in general, and you should bully him mercilessly about it.
Exactly. That is definitely what I want out of this stream. That's what I want. People should just talk to me to say, hey, baguettes suck. I bet people who say that baguettes suck have never eaten one in their entire life.
Wait.
When you say that baguettes suck, you don't mean actual baguettes, by the way. You mean baguettes that you've eaten once in an Australian bakery someplace.
I've been to France and I ate baguettes and I liked them. That's my real opinion.
Real baguettes, you liked it. You fucking... your free speech should happen except if it's the shit talk baguettes.
You heard me here, folks.
That's where he draws the line.
Well, let's draw Muhammad, but, you know, if you're going to talk about baguettes, no.
Don't draw my...
Don't incite violence.
If you draw baguettes and John kills you, it's your own fault.
Exactly. Jesus fucking Christ, dude. thanks a lot to Stylus as well for helping out for this stream. Obviously, thanks everyone who watched this first iteration. It's going to be famous fairly soon, obviously. We all know it is. Thank you, everyone. I do hope that we're going to get to discuss even more stuff and have more people participate and watch and enjoy. This is so that everyone can get to speak, can get to express themselves. The point of art is that everyone can share what is in part of them, what is inside of them. You should always let people...
You should always share your insides with the world.
That's not how you're supposed to word it. You word it not the right way, but
if you have a liver, let people see.
Yeah, exactly. That is a nice cat with a baguette.
This is how the stream it definitely needed to end on a cat smiling thanks to a baguette. A flying baguette.
Is somebody throwing the baguette at the cat?
Well, maybe the cat's throwing it away and is happy because it's throwing the baguette away.
No, he isn't. This isn't what it means. You don't understand a lot, okay? You don't get it. I get it.
This is death of the artist.
You don't
right
understand
here,
psychology. You don't understand the history of psychology.
Someone is throwing the baguette at the cat. So you see, the cat is happy because he's going to have a baguette in his face, in his mouth.
It's obviously a French cat.
And that probably is. I can see it's a French cat. You see, he's got a mustache, so he's French.
But I thought French cats were all female. Is that not how the language goes?
What? No.
Oh.
No.
Un
chat. There's a male word for cat and a female word for cat.
Yeah, but the pronoun.
Oh
my goodness. Someone is throwing it at the cat. Oh, that's terrible.
Yeah, no French
what are you doing,
man.
Patrick?
No French man has ever said
that is French for please no TBP. Just so you know. Exactly. I know French. I learned it in school, and that's what that means.
Yeah. I feel insulted. I feel triggered and offended.
This was the last drawing.
Thank you, everyone. This was the last time we were together because we're never going to have any other stream with these people.
Free Speech Gate 2015.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Dan. Thank you, Patrick. Thank you, Starius. Thank you, Shelby, who was there as well. And thank you, Jen, because you, every single one of you matters. goodbye, everyone. Thanks a lot, and I hope to see you next stream.
As the French say, ciao!
Bye!